I mean, we're literally, we would be doing this anyway.
Yeah.
It's just that we decided to record it. Yes, exactly.
Right. Okay. Here we go. Are you ready? Yo sí estoy en esta silla para verme bonita. Welcome to yet another Drag Race review podcast. I'm your host, Terry Blas.
And I am Chucho Quintero. And this is the J-Words, your home for all things Drag Race Mexico.
Whether you are a first-time listener or a longtime fan, join us as we guide you through all the cultural references, inside jokes, and Mexican chisme you can handle. We're back, Chucho.
Yay, season two.
Yay. So we want to do a little Meet the Queens episode. So like this is our episode zero, right? Or episode zero, however you want to say it. And usually when we do little episodes or like reviews, we have this format we do with housekeeping and stuff. So I do want to do a little bit of housekeeping. Which if you don't know and you're joining us for the first time, is just our like what's been going on in Mexico, Mexican drag, gayness, whatever in Mexico or in the US, but whatever.
Yes, and also like yes, exactly. Latina drag in general. Yeah.
Yeah. So the first thing we have under our housekeeping, we already did a little PSA kind of thing about it that you can check out. But it's about Valentina not being the host of season two, along with Lolita. So yeah, you can go check that out for like our thoughts on it. We discussed in episode two of season one of the J Word, like the pressure of meeting certain expectations when you're Mexican American versus when you're Mexican. And so, you know, I guess just to quickly sum up our feelings is like, you know, we support her, we think she's awesome, we love her, great, do what you got to do. But because of that,
yeah, and also like it's this whole thing with how some audience members perceived like if she was worthy of being the host of Drag Race Mexico, because A, she was born in the U.S., and B, you know, Spanish wasn't, like, her first language, and it's not a language that she is, like, 100% fluent in. Who is, by the way, not even me. And it's something that we have been, you know, discussing since the previous season, because it's something that people would talk about even before she was officially announced as the host. And now, obviously, some bitter Bettys out there are now being like, oh, good, you know, that I'm glad that she's gone because of blah, 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 blah.
Yeah,
and it's like, say, you know, just save that.
Yeah, all I'll say that I didn't say in the PSA is that, like, seeing how people talk, I told you this already, but seeing how people are talking about her online makes me wonder, like, well, is that how people talk about me? You know?
Yeah.
So maybe it is. I don't know. But whatever. Because she's not hosting, that has left open a space for another person to come in. So we now have Tyga Brava from Queen of the Universe coming in to host along with Lolita.
Queen of the Universe.
Yeah. What do you think about that?
I mean, I think it's a great choice. I think it's one of the possibilities that were talked about for the first season. So obviously, as soon as Valentina was not coming back, it was like obvious that it was going to be Tyga. And I loved the first season of Queen of the Universe. I absolutely loved it. For some reason, I didn't watch the second one when it came out, but now I'm watching it. So I'm still on episode four. I already know she wins, of course, but I'm enjoying the show so much. I hate that the show is canceled, because I feel like in the first season, they kind of were finding their footing a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And the second season just kind of like, oh, now we know how to do this. And the format changed. And it's so much fun so far. So it's like, oh, God, I wish it just kept going. So, I mean,
yeah.
I wish that I hope that the show eventually maybe comes back in the U.S. Who knows? Maybe like somebody will pick it up or whatever. But anyway, yeah, Taiga is great, and I cannot wait to see how this turns out.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Our next little item of housekeeping is this clip that's been going around. You sent it to me. I had just seen it like right before you sent it to me. And it's a clip of an interview that I believe is on a YouTube channel. Maybe we'll put it in the notes or whatever. But it's a clip of Salina EsTitties talking about going on Drag Race and how she didn't want to talk about, it's really sad, how she didn't want to talk about her mother's illness and how her mother told her not to talk about it on the show because she didn't want that to be sort of the focus of her story. But also Salina like made the conscious decision not to because she knew what Drag Race fans were already like, you know, and that's really sad. Yeah. So I don't know. What did you think of that?
I mean, it's something that we've known for a long time, which is like, you never know what somebody's going through. So like the least that you can do is be nice to everybody. You know?
Yeah.
Like you don't have to be just like somebody doesn't have to share their sad stories or something with you for you to be kind to them. And also, you know, I'm just sick of talking about like drag fans. And I say drag fans because it happens in Drag Race and it happens in La Más Draga. For first time listeners, La Más Draga is of course a show not unlike Drag Race that is a Mexican show that is on YouTube and that we're going to talk about it many times throughout this season.
Don't bury that you work on. Let's just.
Oh, well, okay. I mean, that I work on, that I do the subtitles for. So if you don't speak Spanish, you can actually watch it. But yeah, like it's something that that the fans of drag shows in general. I don't know what is it about. I mean, fandoms are always crazy, but drag shows, the fandoms of drag shows are particularly insane because they're not only like, you know, they don't only attack people because, I don't know, because they're like protecting their favorite or whatever. No, like they are sometimes vicious, you know, with like people's personal lives. And that's the thing that upsets me the most, to be like, we're supposed to be like different from like, I don't know, like a soccer fandom or like an anime fandom, right, or something. And we're worse. And it's, I don't know, it's very upsetting. And it's sad that, like you said, the queens already know that it's coming. And we've seen it like in previous seasons of Drag Race, especially,
where it affects,
you know, like
how they act.
Yes, because they go in like, oh, I don't want to say anything or do anything, or I cannot come for like the fan favorite or whatever because I'm going to have a terrible time in a year when this airs.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, imagine just being like, yes, I want to go on this show, but it's going to be terrible when it comes out. Like, that's Drag Race now, you know?
That's sad. Yeah. Well, on a lighter note, I want to talk about KCON LA, which is, you're going to be like, what does it have to do with anything? But KCON LA is a K-pop convention / concert in Los Angeles that last year Margaret Ia went to and posted photos of. So this is my like little call shout out to Margaret, because I would like her to, I would like to know if she is going to KCON LA 2024. And who her favorite K-pop bands are. I just need her to tell me, because I want to know. Because you know that's my obsession. So anyway, if you don't know who Margaret Ia is, check out season one of Drag Race Mexico and La Más Draga.
And season one of La Más Draga.
La Más Draga, yeah. Exactly. And I guess, you know, her social media and all that. I think we should get down to business and meet these queens.
So for this episode, we are going to, like you said, we're going to meet the queens. We're going to go one by one and check out their promo looks and just talk about them. And then at the end, we're going to choose our... So we don't toot or boot in the J word. What we do is we have a Chida, which is like our favorite one, and a Churpia, which is our least favorite one. And
my favorite thing is the sound effect you use for Churpia. It's like,
good.
It's like a moose
so
fart.
Yeah.
All right.
Moose fart. So we're gonna do that,
Well.
and the theme was.
Oh, please tell me
somebody,
because I.
Some people were confused about the theme, because it's not just 60s; it's Mexican 60s. So obviously, like, there's not like a whole difference between like the 60s in the U.S. and Mexico, but this feels a little bit more like Mexican 60s.
I guess, but girl, the brief they gave them was dress like Trixie, because like four of them just basically put on Trixie dresses.
So 60s. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was like four of them in a row in the Meet the Queens video. I was like, Trixie, Trixie, Trixie. I was like, damn. All right. So I guess we're going to go through them alphabetically, right?
Mm-hmm.
And let's start. Let's do with our first queen. Let's meet her look. So the first queen we would start with is Chucho. Tell us.
Oh, yes. So Ava Pocket. Or Ava
is it
Pocket.
Ava?
Honestly, I don't remember, but we're going to find out.
I listened and she said Ava.
Okay, so Ava Pocket. And is it because of Polly Pocket? I think
maybe.
She said. Okay.
Well, she also mentioned putting a little thing in your so yeah.
So I'm confused about the look because of the brief, because I don't understand.
Yeah.
Like, it is a good look. I just don't see how it fits the theme. You know what I mean?
Somewhere in Los Angeles, Michelle Visage is screaming because this person. Their makeup is killer. This wig is awesome,
yeah.
But they like velcroed some shit to a bodysuit.
It's weird because like this is very much a performance look, and so I don't see it like as a promo look. Maybe
yeah, it's not
but
what I would have done.
It
for
is
a promo
a good
look.
Performance look. Yeah,
I don't know,
but yeah, sure. I have a pocket. Okay, so
all right.
Next we have Elektra Vandergeel. And let's get this out of the way. Mm-hmm. So on season one of Drag Race Mexico, we had, and I hope I'm not misremembering, but we only had two queens from La Más Draga.
I think that's
on
right.
Drag Race Mexico. We had Gala Baro, and we had Margaret Dia. We also had, like, that's the thing about Mexican drag. Everybody's mother and everybody's daughter. And it's like just this whole big incestuous family of drag.
Well, right. And like, because so, I remember like seeing Pixie and I was like, oh, that's obviously someone from the same family as Paper Cut and da-da-da, you know, who was on La Más Draga. So, yeah.
Yes. So so basically like everybody's like connected, but like people.
So it's just going to happen.
On the actual show of La Más Draga, we only had Galavaro and Margaret. And now we have five queens, five New York girls. We have five queens from La Más Draga on Drag Race Mexico season two. So basically half the cast. And the first one is Elektra Vandergeel, who was on season four of La Más Draga. Now, out of these five queens, and I'm going to get a little bit ahead, I only like two of them.
You only
from,
like
from
two.
What I've
you,
seen.
You only like
I've
two of
seen,
them, or you only like two of their looks?
No. Of what I've seen from them on La Más Draga.
On La Más Draga,
you
okay.
Know, like almost kind of as if I already knew them. You know what I mean? As if
yeah.
I already saw them in like a whole season of drag. So Elektra Vandergeel in season four. I was not a fan. So I want to see what she brings to this new format, because the formats are quite different. Because on La Más Draga, I wasn't a fan. But here,
well,
I love
but it's
this
also
look.
Like one of those things where even just like with Drag Race, there's a queen that like you may not have been a fan of, and then they go on All Stars and you're like, oh yeah, they're kind of different now.
That
or
has
so
happened to me a lot.
Right.
Yes.
So this look, I actually kind of really like.
Yeah.
So the thing that I thought of, which like I don't know how old Elektra is, but I don't think this is probably what was going through her mind, but it's very reminiscent of, not in the musical, but in the original Hairspray film,
mm-hmm.
at the end, there's a dress with like roaches on it and it's like pink and white, yeah. polka dot, right? And so like this kind of is giving me that. But I love the polka dots. I think it's really, I think yeah. it's great. And I like the shape of the, like the silhouette, the shape of the dress. You can even see like, to me, this is great. There's like a hint of the shoe at the bottom and you can see that it's also polka yeah. dot. So that's great. I really like this.
Yeah. I think the thing that I didn't like about her that maybe I don't like in general on drag competitions is that she's like a fashion girl and I'm more a fan of performers. You know what I mean? Mm. So like you can wear literally a leotard, but if you perform the house down boots, I'm going to be your fan. Or you can come in the wrong way with like designer clothes and like I'm gonna be like okay and then what, you know?
I mean, you could also be an amazing performer but have no personality. I'm not talking about anyone specific.
Yes, exactly.
But, you know,
yeah about somebody that was right. That's all that we're gonna say. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, so I'm not like, I'm not trying to be like, oh, I didn't like her in this other show, so I don't like her now. No. More yeah. of like, I want
to
know, I want
to see what, yeah.
what's going to happen. Yes.
Right.
All right. So now we have our second La Más Draga girl. This is Eva Blunt, and she is from La Más Draga season one. So when it was literally just like, a black piece of cloth, a black piece of fabric, and a dream. And half a dream, actually. And yeah. I have to say, like, I didn't like her at all in the first season of La Más Draga. But the minute I saw, like, just her face, like, not even the clothes, like, just her face, it's like, oh my God, is that the same person? Like, is that the same queen that I saw on that first season? Because, like, apparently she's like a whole new queen now. So I'm very intrigued.
Nice. Yeah, I like this look. I think it's a lot of print. Like, I like that there's purple on the kind of like cape area. But like, imagine if, like, if it was broken up a little bit. Like, what if her leggings had been purple, right? Or what if just the dress had been purple? And then, you know, I don't
or,
know.
Or but, if it was just the lining of the cape that had the print.
Right. Yeah. So but I like it. I think it's interesting. It's kind of cool.
Yeah.
That's a big headpiece, but sure. It works.
Yeah. All right. Now let's go with Garzón. Who is not from La Más Draga. So this is the first time that I'm seeing her. And she presented herself like as a dark queen, which is like a one of the more popular kind of like genres of drag here in Mexico. We have a bunch of very, you know, dark girls, and so I'm quite interested. I like her look.
I like this look a lot too. I think unfortunately this photo, like, the it doesn't have the green poof shawl kind of thing. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make it look good. But in the promo videos, it looks great. Yeah. So this photo, I don't know, but like I do like the outfit. Yeah, I think it's cool.
Yeah,
I like that it's black and white, but that like that one big pop of color is that poof thing.
Yeah, she's coming for Bob's geek.
Yeah, she's got a fashion headache.
How do you call that in English again? Houndstooth?
Houndstooth, yeah.
So, like, the tooth of a hound, which is a dog, right? Okay.
I know, and it doesn't look anything like that.
I don't know what happened. No, wait. I don't know what happened, but in Mexico, we call it pata de gallo.
Oh.
So, a rooster's foot.
Interesting.
Like, I don't know how either of those make sense, but whatever.
Yeah, but whatever. So who is next?
Okay, next is Horacio Potasio, who is I guess because of Ugacio Crujiente, which is from Drag Race Spain, it's giving me very much like a Spain kind of a Spanish kind of name for a queen, you know?
Not, yeah.
But anyway, I don't know what I'm looking at.
I don't either. I don't either. It kind of makes no sense to me.
Yeah. I understand this idea of like, you know, I'm just going to be like sexy and wear like panties or whatever. But this genuinely feels like it has half of the outfit missing.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Yeah. Like it feels like there's something that should be there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The cape is cute.
Yeah, it's all right. I don't know. Yeah. Let's move on to the next one.
Okay, so the next one is Dawn. I mean, Ignus Ars.
Oh my God, how dare and, you!
She looks great. I really love this look. I really love this. What was the name of the queen from Canada's Drag Race, the last season of Canada's Drag Race? The trans guy. Denim, yes. So it's giving me like Dawn meets Denim meets Alexis 3XL, who is from La Madraga, meets Evie Oatley.
Well, that was her original drag name, did you know?
Which one?
Denim Dawn.
She was called Miss Clea.
Yeah. I will say that I like this. I don't think it needs that silver thing behind it.
Like I literally just noticed it.
Yeah, it doesn't need it. But I also, like, it's okay. It's cool. But it does make me interested to see what she'll do next or what they'll do next.
Yeah.
I will say that, the only thing that I found kind of like, come on, was that they did the typical, and I say typical because, like, we've heard this a million times, like, Ignus isn't like really a man or a woman. They're like an alien from like, it's like, oh my God. Sure.
I mean, she's fighting for that spot hosting Drag Race Mars, right, along with like Tammy Brown and every single other alien queen that we've had.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, as usual, it's going to be interesting seeing how they interpret, you know, every challenge for the drag, or if they don't and they go home. So let's see.
All right. Let's go on to the next one. All
right. Now, next we have Jenari Bloom. And I like this.
I do too. I think it's kind of interesting. Yeah. I like that, like, the flowers are kind of coming out of the titties. The face and the hair is kind of giving me a little bit of, like, Gigi Good.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think it's fun. I like it. Why not?
Yeah.
I'll be interested to see what she does.
All right. And next we have another La Mastraca girl. And this one I actually like. I enjoyed her in her season. And in her season of La Mastraca, she was like 12. You know, like she's very, very young. Still to this day,
I liked her on La Mastraga.
Her name is her name is Lexa Fox. I didn't say it. And the thing about Lexa Fox is that she's a performer. She's very funny. She sings. So I don't know about, you know, the looks. I don't know if she's gonna give if she's gonna be serving looks. But she's definitely going to ace, you know, the comedy challenges and the performing challenges. So yeah,
I liked her on La Mastraga. I think I'm excited. Yeah. I mean, I'm excited to see what she does. But this look is, I think it's fine. It whatever.
Yeah, I mean,
who's
it's
next?
It's basically a look. So yeah.
Next is IQ Kitty.
Next is Luna Landsman, and Luna Landsman is also from La Mastraga, and I also did not enjoy her during her season. When I say I don't enjoy a queen, it's just that I wasn't like intrigued about them, you know, like I wasn't like waiting to see what they were gonna do next. So you know, she's here and she's wearing a pink dress. That's all I
she did call herself she called herself the unicorn queen. So she better bring that.
I don't remember unicorns being like, you know, a thing on her drag during La Maltraga, but sure.
I know. But I think she meant that because she's wearing this thing that's very like Lisa Frank pop kind of cute color, whatever. You know, you can see in her hair, whatever. It works. It's fine. Great.
Sure. There's room for everybody. Let's just say that.
Yeah.
Up next is Maria Bonita, who is actually wearing like basically Janari Bloom's purse, but as a dress. And Maria Bonita is one of those queens that is not from La Más Draga, but she's like the drag sibling of like 10 queens from La Más Draga, like the drag aunt of like 20 queens from La Más Draga, and it's just like a big happy family. So I have heard her name before. It's just like the first time that I'm actually seeing her. And this is actually a cute promo look. You know what I mean?
I
feel like she aced like the photo, because we've seen some looks that they were probably good looks, but like the photo wasn't great. And I feel like this is a great photo.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think it's really cool. It's like just, you know, the way she posed in it in this photo too, is like it accentuates the idea that she's just wearing a bow, even though it's, you know, a dress. But yeah, it's cute. I like it a lot.
All right. And up next is Nina La Fuente. And Nina La Fuente is also from La Más Draga. And I do like her very much. The problem with Nina La Fuente is that she was the first one out on season 2 of La Más Draga. And out of every queen that has been the first one out from La Más Draga, this is the most unfair elimination of all time in the history of La Más Draga. Because her look, and I'm going to put it right here, her look was incredible. Her makeup was to die for. Like, it was just like a masterpiece. But what happened was, because La Más Draga is all about, not just about like your look and your makeup, but also how you perform on the runway, you know, how you present the look or how you tell like a little story on the runway or whatever. I remember that she put down like a, because it was like a religious theme, so she put down like a Bible or like a like candles or something like in the at the front of the stage, and then when she turned around, she knocked them down with her cape, and so that's literally what the judges were like, well, you knocked your props down, and so you should have rehearsed more. And they sent her to the bottom.
Yeah.
And they sent her to the bottom. And obviously she lost the lip sync because, you know, the other queen was, you know, a better lip syncer. But she shouldn't have been in the bottom in the first place. And it's just ridiculous. Anyway, I've been bitter about that for many years. And now I'm happy to see Nina de la Fuente is back on TV and on Drag Race. So, yeah.
I don't like this look.
I don't either.
Like, I don't understand the dress. I don't understand the length of the dress. I don't understand the shoes with it. I don't understand the headpiece.
The thing that bothers me. Like,
remove the headpiece and imagine if most of the dress was made from the things that are on her shoulders.
Yeah.
Girl. Like, and I don't know. She's got this, like, is she trying to do, like, Jessica Rabbit's mom?
Like, I don't know. She's trying to do like pork chop meets Nina West.
It's weird. I don't know about this look.
Yeah.
No. Hang on. I'm going to write it down as one of my possibilities of like.
Oh, no. All right. Now, up next is Suculenta. And I'm very confused about this queen because I think she's wearing a fat suit. But I think it's part of her drag, like her drag character, because in the Meet the Queens, she pointed at it. Like she was like, oh yeah, like, you know, but it's not, like, it's very clear that she's not a big girl. It's clear that it's kind of like a fat suit, but I don't know if it's just for this look or if she's always going to wear one. Like, I'm very confused. But I actually like this Oompa Loompa realness, you know?
How weird. I don't think, like the dress itself doesn't, she doesn't need this fat suit. Like, why? And, like, that's so controversial. She's going to get talked about.
Yeah, I just don't get it.
I don't know.
Out of all the go-go boots that we've seen today, these are my favorite, actually.
Yeah, they're really good boots. I don't know how I feel about it. I'm so confused.
I was going to say, trend alert, go-go boots.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I mean, it is a cute dress. The wig is just clashing so hard with that dress.
Well, so that's I think my issue is like the okay. So there, she has these bright yellow boots, right?
Yeah.
To me, they clash with her gold yellow gloves and flowers. Then her green wig clashes with the green bits on her dress. Then the pink parts of her dress clash with the pink parts of her bodysuit. Like, it's too much. Like, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean,
anyway,
we'll see. And now we have Unique.
Trixie
and,
number four.
and she is a love bug or a love cow. How do you call that?
Yeah, like a VW bug or whatever.
Yes, exactly. No, yeah. Because we call those bochos in Mexico.
Girl, those are taxis in Mexico.
She's dressed as a, yes, because she's dressed as a bochito, as a bocho. And I like the dress. I like the idea of the dress.
I do too. I think it's kind of cute.
I wish the
boots had been a little shorter
yes,
to like emphasize
yes,
the dress.
Yes.
But whatever. The yes, boots need to be shorter.
But yeah, I mean, Trixie looks great here. So yeah.
Yeah. I always thought there should be a drag queen named Unique New York, because like that's the dumb little warm up that drama kids say all the time. So I like that her name's Unique. That's cute. I think her makeup's really good. I like the color of the wig and the dress is cute, but like, yeah, I think it's just the boots that need to be different. Yeah. She should have had a little like something car themed in her hair instead of hearts.
Yeah. Or like
like a little steering wheel.
Yeah. All right. So, well, now let's pick our Chida and our Churpia of this week. And I have both already, so I can start if you want.
Yes, you go first.
Okay, so my Chida of the week is actually Maria Bonita. You know,
oh,
I feel
okay,
like the marriage between photo and posing and the outfit and, you know, the makeup, the hair, I think that everything kind of like it's giving like great promo look. So yeah, Maria Bonita is my Chida of the week. And my Churpia of the week, just because like her bags got lost in the plane or something, in the plane to Colombia. We're gonna talk about that later. And but Horacio Potasio is my Churpia of the week. So okay. Yeah.
So you've actually made it a little bit easier on me, because Horacio was one of my choices for my Churpia, and Maria Bonita was one of my choices for maybe Chida, right? But because you chose those, I'm going to choose two different ones. So that's making it a little bit easier for me.
Okay.
So my Chida of the week actually goes to Electra Vandergilt.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's cool. I like it.
Yeah.
And my Churpia of the week.
Oh, God.
Ugh. There's two I can't choose between, but
just say it. No, just say the one that I know you want to say.
Nina, sorry.
Yes, sorry. Yes. No, I know. No, I know. I know. No. Yeah. You're right.
It's just wrong.
Yeah.
Special shout out to Ava Pocket, because girl, I don't know. But anyway. So yeah, we also. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm excited to see what they do and what they bring, because like we said, you know, Nina could come out in something amazing in the first episode and like blow us all away. Like, who knows? And yeah. I think that's part of the fun of Drag Race, is that like from week to week, you don't really know what you're going to get. And that's like sort of the fun surprise of it, right?
Yeah.
And so I guess we'll find out. Is there anything you're looking like really forward to this season on the show?
So I'm not looking forward to seeing our dear friend Oscar Madrazo once again.
Yeah, no,
on that judges panel. So many people were like, wait, we asked you to get rid of one of them, but you got rid of the wrong one.
Yeah.
You got rid of Valentina instead of Oscar. I just hope that he saw himself on the show and he kind of like understood, you know, how to say something that made a little bit more sense now, because it's just like, anyway, I'm gonna go in with an open mind, but I just don't enjoy him at all. But I just hope that, you know, now that they kind of went through a first season that had its ups and downs and that was a little bit, you know, all over the place when they shot it, so they had to kind of like save it in the editing and everything, and it was like a whole thing that we all found out later. I hope that now, from the get-go, they were able to have a great season that didn't have to be rescued in post-production, yeah. You know? Because something that will be, you know, continuously the best part of the season of a season of Drag Race Mexico is always going to be the queens. You know, the queens are always going to be great. They were great on season one. They will look very promising on season two, especially the ones, you know, that I already know. I know they're going to be great on the show, but the show has to be as great as them for them to be able to shine properly. So, yeah, that's yeah. all. And I hope that we don't get one queen that wins like 10 challenges, because it's like,
oh,
that,
God, I mean, come on.
Good for them, but like, we don't need that anymore. We're done with
no.
that. In any Drag Race spinoff, we just don't want that anymore, please.
Right, no. I'm excited for a full trailer and to see who some of the guest judges are. I have one last thing to do, which we usually do in our little episodes if you are watching us for the first time. I like to share fan art that people do of the queens.
Yes.
For our fan art, I have something from our beloved Chucho Chocolatin.
Yes.
And we showed some of his stuff in the last season, because always doing some really great stuff. So there's a post. He has three posts on his social media right now on Instagram that are three queens each. So he's kind of like, he's drawn, I think, almost all of the queens from this season in their promo looks. And it's really cool. So that's his stuff. Go check his stuff out. Give him some love and like his posts. Yeah. And yeah. If you see or find any fan art that you think is cool, you can totally send it to us. Chucho, in the spirit of that, where can people find you?
Well, you can find me still on Twitter. and Chucho _Q. And on Instagram, Chucho _QMP. And that's it. Those are going to be my socials for the season.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Terry Blas, and at my website, terryblas.com.
Yes, we're going to keep it short this season.
You know what?
We're giving out our grinder handles last season and everything, and it was like a whole thing.
I don't have grinder, honey. I don't know what you're talking about.
Find me 10 feet away. You can find me 10 feet away from you.
Writing a review anyway. On Letterboxd. You can find me at this bar. That was you. Well, that's all it right. For this episode. Thank you for joining us. Until next time, and as always, respeta tu cultura, marico.
Reggaeton, jamás. Hoy es el 15 de septiembre, marico. Respeta tu cultura, como el reggaeton.